Today we're going to do a demonstration dissection of a cow's eye. This is a preserved cow's eye. On some of the eyes you may see remnants of the eyelid. So this part that I'm pulling down with my thumb here, this is probably the lower or upper eyelid. It's hard to tell. If we look at the back of the eye, we see a lot of fat, and that's there for protection. This sits into a bony socket of the skull, so we need a lot of protection, and that's what the fat does. You also will see muscle. The brownish material here are the big muscles that would move the eye up, down, right, or left. And sticking out from the back of the eye, right here, we see the optic nerve. And of course, the optic nerves then would cross underneath the brain in the optic chiasma, which you learned when you did the sheep brain. The optic nerves carry the impulses from the back of the eye to the brain to be interpreted as sight. If we look at the anterior or front of the eyeball, we see this shriveled up grayish structure. This is the cornea of the eye. Normally this should be clear and it should be puffed out and filled with a fluid called aqueous humor. I'm just going to squeeze the eyeball, and there you can see the way the cornea should be, but the aqueous humor doesn't preserve very well and leaks out, and so you get this collapsed, shriveled up cornea. Cornea is very tough and does some of the bending of light rays. The rest of this outer covering is the sclera, and this all, or the white of the eye. This is very tough, as you will find out when you try to cut into that. This is primarily for protection, protects the eyeball. When you dissect, you want to take a scalpel with the cornea on one end and the optic nerve at the other. You want to slice slightly behind the cornea, somewhere here. Don't try to cut through the heavy muscles. In your lab book, figure 11.2 shows you where you should cut approximately. Again, if you're off a little, it doesn't make a difference. Dare I say you could eyeball it. Take the point of the scalpel, and you're going to need to puncture this. Now, the back of the eye is filled with a jelly-like fluid called vitreous humor. So you might get some of that oozing out. Don't worry about it. So that was fairly tough. That's why I used the point of the scalpel. Now, you can continue with the scalpel like this, or you could take a scissors then and cut around the eye. Okay, I prefer the scalpel because now we're going into some muscle. And the lower eyelid, which is going to present a problem. I'm going to try to go anterior to that. Well, maybe I will go back to the scissors. So we're going to separate the eyeball from the anterior part from the posterior part. This is a lot tougher than cutting coupons. So there, in all its glory, is the vitreous humor, this jelly-like substance. We're going to clear out the vitreous humor from the anterior part of the eyeball. I know it's not polite to use your fingers, but I don't think an etiquette book has been written for eyeball dissections. Here we see the lens, and we're looking from the inside of the eyeball out. The lens should normally be crystal clear. This is cloudy because it is a preserved eyeball. The lens is held in place by this circular structure called the ciliary body. The ciliary body has these little radiating lines. And the actual attachment between the ciliary body and the lens is very small ligaments called suspensory ligaments. You won't be able to see those, but when you remove the lens, you'll notice that there is some resistance, and those are the suspensory ligaments that you have to rip in order to remove the lens. In fact, you can see, maybe you can see that right here, the suspensory ligaments. I don't know if the camera can pick it up. So we're going to remove the lens. The lens is fairly hard. It is made up of layers of protein. So you could take this and, with your fingernail, peel off layers like an onion, layers of protein. Sometimes these protein layers become opaque, and that's what we call a cataract. And then they have to remove the whole lens and put in an artificial lens. The shape of the lens is controlled by that ciliary body. So if we go back to the eyeball, the ciliary body has muscles that control the shape of the lens in order to form a clear image in the back part of the eye. When you look at something far away, the lens is elongated, is stretched by the ciliary body. When you look at something close up, the ciliary body relaxes and the lens balls up, becomes more rounded, so you could read close work. Unfortunately, as we age, the lens becomes less and less elastic, and therefore we become, we have poorer close vision. So we become more farsighted and we can't see close up. Therefore, we need reading glasses. And there's a little exercise in today's lab called near point accommodation that could kind of demonstrate that process. We took the lens out, and you can see there's another black structure here. That's the iris. The iris is the colored part of the eye. If you have blue eyes, you have a blue iris, or brown eyes, brown iris. But the point of the iris is not to give color to the eyeball, but to regulate the size of this opening in the middle of the iris. That's called the pupil. And the pupil size is smaller when you're in bright light and the iris pulls back and the pupil becomes larger in low light levels. And then you can see the underside of the cornea through the pupil. So the light goes through the cornea, through the pupil, through the lens, through this vitreous humor, and to the back of the eye. So if we take a look at the back of the eye, this paper-thin layer is the retina. That is the nervous layer of the eye that has the rod and cone cells for vision. If we remove some of the vitreous, again, excuse my fingers, you can see that the retina comes off very easily. I guess I can't remove it too much. I don't know if the camera can pick it up, but right there is a point where the retina is attached more so than the rest of the eye. Normally the retina is attached all the way around, but this is a preserved eye, so it comes off easily. Right there is where the optic nerve leaves the back of the eye. That's the blind spot. There are no rod or cone cells there, so there is no vision there. Again, there's an exercise in today's lab to help demonstrate the blind spot. You can also, maybe the camera can pick up some faint little red lines, one here, one here. These are the blood vessels or capillaries that enter the back of the eye and nourish the retina. Well, we're going to remove the retina here and look at the dark layer right beneath it, which is called the choroid. That's where you see where the retina is still attached to that blind spot. I guess we'll just leave it. This choroid layer absorbs light. In some animals, there is an iridescent part, an iridescent blue or green. This is a bluish green. When driving at night on a highway and you see two green eyes off the side of the road that the headlights catch, those are animals that have this particular structure in their choroid. This area is called the tapetum lucidum. Cows have it, deer, dogs, and cats. We do not. Our choroid is all heavily pigmented, black. We don't have this iridescent part. This gives animals a little better night vision. It reflects some of the light back through the retina, so it stimulates the retina a little more than if it wasn't there. The function of the choroid, one of the functions, is to absorb light. Just like the inside of the camera is always black, to absorb light, and we want the inside of our eyeball to be black. We want the light to come in, stimulate the retina, and then get absorbed by the choroid. We don't want light bouncing around in our eyeball, overexposing the retina. If we peel the choroid back, then what's left is the sclera. So right here, all of this tough part is the sclera, the white of the eye, and as I mentioned before, it's there primarily for protection. And that concludes the demonstration dissection of the eye. That's the white of the eye, the tough part, and it's primarily there for protection. And that concludes the demonstration dissection of the eye.